Good morning. Wes had asked me to do a Sunday school lesson, and so that's what we're going to do this morning, and I hope it's a blessing to you. I needed to read you something important that was given to me before we start, and I did run it by Kim, so it's okay if I read it. It's about a blonde lady. It said she was so blonde that she saw the quarterback, thought a quarterback was a refund. She thought General Motors was in the Army. She thought Meow Mix was a CD for cats. She thought Boys to Men was a daycare center. At the bottom of an application where it says sign here, she wrote Sagittarius. She was so blonde, she took the ruler to bed to see how long she slept. She sent a fax with a stamp on it. Under education on her job application, she put hooked on phonics. She was so blonde that she tripped over a cordless phone. She spent 20 minutes looking at the orange juice can because it said concentrate. She told me to meet her at the corner of walk and don't walk. She tried to put the M&Ms in alphabetical order. She is so blonde, she studied for a blood test. She sold the car for gas money. When she missed bus 44, she took bus 22 twice instead. When she went to the airport and saw a sign that said airport left, she turned around and went home. She was so blonde that when she heard that 90% of all crimes occur around home, she moved. She thought if she spoke her mind, she'd be speechless. She thought that she could use her AM radio only in the evening. Now, I know that that doesn't pertain to anybody in our class, anybody that I would be speaking to, but I thought you might appreciate it, okay? Hey, what I want to talk about today, I've been reading a book. I finished reading it just not long ago. And the title of the book is Keeping Your Ethical Edge. By the way, I have a copy of the book here. If you'll send $5 in, we'll send you the book and we'll send you a handkerchief with it, okay? Anyway, it's called Keeping Your Ethical Edge Sharp. And one of the chapters in it really made an impression on me, and I thought that I would like to share it with you. And maybe it'd be a blessing to you, maybe help all of us to keep ourselves in the position where we ought to be. Title of the lesson, Count Me Out. Count Me Out. And I want to read Romans 12, verse 2 to you. It'll be real familiar, but let's launch from there. Paul says this, he says, "Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." The keywords I'm looking at there, Paul says, be not conformed to this world. You'll read a lot of people that will use J.B. Phillips' translation. I don't know about him. It's an older translation, but I've heard this a number of times, and I want to read you how he translates this. He says, we translate be not conformed. He says, don't let the world around you squeeze you into its mold. Don't let the world around you squeeze you into its mold. That's what the world will try to do. That's what a lost world naturally does. Question I want to ask you, have you ever experienced peer pressure? I'm sure everybody at some time or another has experienced peer pressure. I think it starts in elementary school. If it doesn't start earlier than that, you can't be somebody's friend or they won't include you unless you do what they say. And as a result, many of us in our lives end up bowing to the peer pressure. We go against our conscience to keep from being rejected or ostracized, or to keep somebody from making fun of us, and we end up doing things we wouldn't normally do. Peer pressure is a powerful thing. I believe it's really tough on kids in school. I don't think that I appreciated this for a long time in my life, but the older I get and seeing grandkids, I understand it's tough on kids in school. There's a lot of peer pressure. I'll tell you a story that I remember. We lived in Nashville when I was in second and third grade, and I'd get in trouble and they'd take me down to the principal's office. Now, I know that's hard for you to imagine, but they did. And they called my mom and dad. And when mom and dad would come down there, I can remember hearing them say, I'd be sitting outside the office, they'd say, he's basically a good boy, but when he gets hooked up with these other boys, he does things that he knows better than to do. And they said that I was just a follower. And I suppose I was. Peer pressure. They dared me to do it, and they did it, so I did it. I was thinking of another time. I remember the first time before I got saved when I ever drank beer. We were driving down the road with a bunch of guys that I played ball with, and they were handing out cans of beer, and I remember they gave me a can of beer, and I was in the back seat of the car, and I started drinking it. Well, I didn't want to think I was scared to drink beer, but I didn't want to go home drunk or with alcohol on my breath. And my dad found that out. And so I was scared of my dad, but at the same time, I didn't want the peer pressure from them. I remember drinking half of it and waiting for them to look off so I could throw it out and they'd think that I drank the whole can. Peer pressure, just people putting pressure on you as far as what you ought to do. Peer pressure doesn't go away when you become an adult. I experience it often. I'm sure you do too. I was trying to think of some of the things that come to my mind that I experienced in my life, peer pressure. One of them that came to my mind, Kim and I will go to large meetings that had to do with suppliers of ours, the rubber companies, and they'll have these elaborate banquets at these nice hotels at the end of the night, or maybe even a meal in the daytime. And you'll have two glasses sitting in front of you. Both of them are wine glasses. And they'll come by and they'll try to pour some wine for you and you politely turn them down. They'll come back 5 minutes later. They'll come back 10 minutes later. You're the only people at the table not drinking wine. Peer pressure. Now, I have to say that doesn't bother me a lot, but it's pretty obvious when it happens. If you stay around those meetings long enough at those conventions, after everything's done, the meal's over, a lot of times there's a dance floor and people will start hitting the dance floor. If you hang around, somebody's going to ask you to dance. Somebody's going to expect you to get up on the dance floor. The best thing I've found to do is to get up, excuse yourself, and go to your room. Peer pressure. Being around somebody, they're doing things that they want you to do. In business, and I'm sure this is true for you and what you do, oftentimes, if you just fudge the truth a little bit, you can make the sale or you can make some money. Or things will work out for you if you're just willing to fudge the truth. If you work with people that aren't Christians, you'll get pressure to do that. And they won't understand why you won't do that. And it'll just cause problem. It's natural to want to belong. It's natural to want to be a part of things. And it's not fun when you're left out. But if you're going to honor God and if you're going to maintain your character, there's going to have to be times when you say, just count me out. Just count me out. I thank the Lord when I got saved. I was, Mark was my friend. Brother Thrift became my pastor shortly after that. I went to two really good colleges that enforced this, and we were taught to be counted out of a lot of things. If you were the only guy in the world not doing it, that's okay. And if you were the last guy in the world serving God, that's okay. I was reading about Elisha the other day. He was serving the Lord and came under a lot of pressure. And he told the Lord that he was the only one still serving the Lord. Well, you'll remember what God told him. He said, no, that's not true. I reserved 7,000 that have not bowed the knee to Baal. But sometimes we feel like that, and sometimes it brings on a lot of pressure. What I want to do, I want to talk about three things with this that might be a blessing to you and help you to focus your thoughts on how to address this. The first thing I want to say is be careful about what others think. Be careful about what others think. I don't mean that like it sounds or like you might take it. I mean, don't give what people think more weight than it deserves. Don't give what other people think about what you do more weight than what it deserves. We read in a number of places in the Old Testament, just got through with it a few months back in Judges, where it's repeated, every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Well, that's still what happens today. Every man does what's right in his own eyes. The issue is you and I have committed ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ, and we've given ourselves to do what's right in His eyes. So we're going to stand out, and it's going to be noticed. Other people's opinions about who we are and what we do is not really that important. The only way that I would consider that much is if it was another godly Christian that was trying to advise me. But other than that, the world's opinion about who we are and what we do is not really important. I've heard it said lately, and I want to think it was Wes that quoted it. Somebody said, if we displease God, it doesn't matter who we please. If we please God, it doesn't matter who we displease. If we displease God, it doesn't matter who we please. If we please God, it doesn't matter who we displease. So the question becomes this, am I going to allow others to define who I am, or will God and I define who I am? The urge to belong has to take a back seat when it comes to your integrity. Has to take a back seat when it comes to your integrity. Worrying too much about what other people think is damaging to you emotionally, and it's damaging to you spiritually. You talk about a person that's tortured is the person that all the time is worried about what somebody thinks about what they're doing or who they are, and they don't have the confidence in themselves to live. And it'll give you problems spiritually too. If you let that, you bring battles upon yourself that you don't need to bring upon you when you worry too much about what other people think. What does the scripture have to say on the subject? What does the Bible have to say? Well, Proverbs 29:25 says that the fear of man bringeth a snare. It's a trap to you if you get caught fearing men and worrying about too much about what they think. Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 2, "Cease ye from man whose breath is in his nostrils, for wherein is he to be accounted of?" Isaiah said, hey, cease ye from men. Back off from that. He's just a man. He's just a man. Galatians chapter 1, verse 10, the Apostle Paul, he says, "For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ." Paul knew that he had two people he could choose to please. He could either please God and the Lord Jesus Christ, or he could please men. And Paul had made up his mind right after the Damascus Road what his trek was going to be, and his heart was going to be in to serve God. Who do you think were the people in the Bible that received the most scathing rebuke from the Lord Jesus? You and I both know who they are. They were the Pharisees. Listen to what, this is how a Pharisee's mindset was. And listen to what Jesus said about the Pharisees. In Matthew chapter 23, he said this. He said, "But all their works they do to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries. They enlarge the borders of their garments and love the uppermost rooms at the feast and the chief seats in the synagogues and greetings in the marketplace and to be called of men, Rabbi, Rabbi." He said what they did to be seen of men so men could see it. He said they loved the uppermost rooms. He said they loved the chief seats of the synagogues. These are religious people. These are religious people. And they so want to look good in men's sight, and they're so worried about what men think that they forget about God. Let me read you one last verse. John chapter 5, verse 44. Jesus speaking, he said, "How can you believe which receive honor one of another and seek not the honor that cometh from God only?" Which receive honor one of another and seek not the honor that cometh from God only. Really often, you're going to have a plain choice. You can either seek honor from men or you can seek honor from God, but you can't have both. You have to choose one or the other. So don't be so concerned about what people think. Let me give you the second thought that I want to say. Be concerned about what God thinks. Be concerned about what God thinks. Deuteronomy chapter 10, Moses writes, "And now Israel, what doth the Lord thy God require of thee? But to fear the Lord thy God, and to walk in his ways, and to love him, and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes, which I command ye this day for thy good." What's Moses saying? He's saying, here's what the Lord requires of you. And the first thing he says he requires of you, to fear him. This is an awesome reverential fear that says, I know who God is. And he's the almighty God of the universe, and I love him and I fear him, to walk in his ways, love him, serve him with all your heart and all your soul. I need to be concerned about what God thinks. You remember what Brother Olof used to say? He used to say, let God be true and every man a liar. Kind of falls in line with what this is. Psalms 33:8, David said, let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. I don't need to worry about what men think. I need to worry about what God thinks. And I want to fear him, and I want to stand in awe of God. I want to stand in awe of God. Again, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 7. Be not wise in thine own eyes, but fear the Lord and depart from evil. Be concerned about what God says. Be concerned about what God thinks, and fear him, and let it take you away from evil. Jesus lived to please his heavenly Father. Why shouldn't that be my goal, to live to please my heavenly Father? If I wanted to please my earthly father, how much more should I want to please my heavenly Father? So when our main purpose is to please God, certain benefits come in our lives, and there's certain things God says that we have if we choose to make that choice. I want to read you some of them. If we choose to be concerned about what God thinks and fear the Lord, we'll receive honor from God. psalmist said in Psalms 15, in whose eyes a vile person is condemned, but he honoreth them that feareth the Lord. God honors them that fear the Lord. God will honor your life. God will honor my life if I'll fear him and not fear men. If we fear the Lord and think about what pleases him, we experience intimacy with God. Psalms chapter 25, 14, the secret of the Lord is with them that fear him, and he will show them his covenant. The man that walks with God and the man that cares what God thinks will learn about God's covenant. He'll understand things that other people won't understand at all about God. Another thing, we'll feel his love and his concern. Psalms chapter 33, 18 says, behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him and upon them that hope in his mercy. You'll feel the love and concern of God, that his eye is upon you, that he's watching you. The Lord taketh pleasure, Psalms 147, the Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear him and those that hope in his mercy. The Lord takes pleasure in the person that fears God and that cares what God thinks more than anything else. Another thing, we'll have and feel God's protection. Psalms 34, 7, the angel of the Lord encampeth about them that fear him and delivereth them. The angel of God's around them, that is around those that fear him. You don't see him and I don't see him, but it would be amazing if we knew the activity of the angels that take place in this world, and it's toward those that fear God. Psalms 85, 9, surely his salvation is nigh unto them that fear him. Proverbs 14, 26, this is a great verse. It's a great verse. In the fear of the Lord is strong confidence, and his children shall have a place of refuge. You wonder sometimes why you don't have the confidence you ought to have? I have it. The same thing. I go through times without confidence. I'm not walking with God like I should. Right now, during this coronavirus, this COVID-19 thing, there's a lot of uncertainties. There's a lot of uncertainties about your job. There's a lot of uncertainties about your income. If you have a business, there's a lot of uncertainties about your business. I can guarantee you that a ton of people are going to be bankrupt in this, and there's nothing they can do about it to an extent. You know what Brother Gary told me the other day? We were talking about business, and he was talking about somebody that wanted him to do a certain thing if he worked with them. And he said he couldn't do that. And they said, well, if you don't do that, then we're not going to be able to give you this business. And Brother Gary told me that he said to them, he said, well, you're not my source anyway. God's my source. God takes care of me, and God's my source. And you've got to look at it like that. In the fear of the Lord is strong confidence. Walk with God, and he'll give you a confidence that you won't have and you can't get any other way. And he says in here that his children shall have a place of refuge. So we'll feel God's protection if we honor God and put him first and what he thinks first. God meets our needs when we do that. Psalms 34, 9 and 10. Oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there's no want to them that fear him. They get what they need. There's no want to them that fear him. He said, the young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. Man, when you're walking with God and you can claim that promise, it means everything. It means everything. Another thing, we learn true wisdom when we fear the Lord more than men. We learn true wisdom. Proverbs 1:7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Psalms 9, verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. You'll learn true wisdom if you'll fear the Lord first. Now, men will teach you what they call wisdom, but it's the wisdom of this world. And though it may work for you in short term, it won't work for you in long term, and it definitely won't serve you well in eternity. If I choose to honor the Lord and care about what God thinks more than men, most likely I'll enjoy a prolonged life. Now, I know everybody that's saved and that's a Christian that follows the Lord doesn't live forever, but the general rule is that they live longer, that'll walk with God. They don't get into sin that destroys them nearly as bad. Proverbs 10 is where I'm coming from. The fear of the Lord prolongeth days, but the years of the wicked shall be shortened. The fear of the Lord, Proverbs 19, tendeth to life, and he that hath it shall abide satisfied. One last benefit, if you'll fear the Lord rather than men, is you can avoid evil. We'll avoid evil. Psalms or Proverbs 16, 6, by the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. You know, you don't have much motivation at all if you're not a Christian to depart from evil. But if you're a Christian and you fear the Lord, you have a desire to depart from evil because you don't want it affecting your life and you don't want it messing you up. Let me give you one other thing when we're talking about caring what God thinks. If you'll stand up, if I stand up for the Lord, it'll benefit others when we stand up and stand out for God. It'll benefit other people. Some folks need courage. Your boldness will help them to stand. Your boldness will help them. I remember when I was preparing this, I thought about a time we had one of these meetings up in Indiana, in a little town in Indiana, and they had the meeting on Sunday, the Michelin group. They had the meeting on Sunday because we were going to a game on Monday night or whatever. So when it came to Sunday morning, man, I gave Sunday morning to the Lord 40-something years ago when I got saved, and I was not interested in sitting in a meeting on Sunday morning if I didn't have to. So I looked up a church. There's a little church down the street, about 2 or 3 blocks down the street, and I told the moderator of the meeting, the main guy who was a professing Christian himself, that he needed to excuse me, that I was going to disappear about 10:45 and I'd reappear about 12:15 or whatever, and he said, okay. Went to the service. It was a great service. Don't even know the name of the church. It was a great service. And I remember at lunchtime, a couple of guys asked me, they said, hey, where'd you go? How come you left? And I told them what I did. And they said, man, I wish you'd have told us. We would have gone with you. So they weren't into going by themselves. But if I had mentioned it to them, they would have gone with me. If you'll walk with the Lord, you'll encourage somebody else. I can't tell you how many times in my life people have encouraged me like that. They hit the altar. They did this. They did that. And it stirred my heart to follow Jesus and to stand out for Jesus because I care what he thinks. Since I'm saved, and I want to please the Lord. So let me give you a third thing and the last thing, okay? The third thing is a question. Why am I here? Why am I here? Well, Jesus addressed that. I want to read you in Matthew chapter 5, verse 10 to verse 16. Listen to me as I read. He said, blessed are they, the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. These people are pleasing the Lord, and they're getting in trouble with men because of it. And he goes on in verse 13, he says, you're the salt of the earth. But if the salt hath lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It's thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden underfoot of men. You're the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle, but put it under a bushel, or put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. When I'm persecuted, when I'm insulted, when I'm ostracized for Jesus' sake, and I take it patiently, I can rejoice because I know it pleases my Heavenly Father. I'm here to glorify God. You're here to glorify God. That's the answer to why we're here. And he says in the sermon, he says, I'm to be like salt. I want to read you something William Hendrickson said about salt that I thought was good that helps to apply this to ourselves. He says, though salt has many characteristics, whiteness, pungency, flavor, preservative power, etc., it is probably especially the last quality, the potency of salt as an antiseptic, a substance that prevents and retards decay, upon which the emphasis falls here, though the subsidiary function of imparting flavor must obviously not be excluded. Salt, then, has a negative function. It combats deterioration. Similarly, Christians, by showing themselves to be Christians indeed, are constantly combating moral and spiritual decay. How often does it not happen that when a believer suddenly steps into a crowd of worldly individuals, the off-color joke by which someone was about to entertain his companions is held back. The profanity is left unspoken. The wicked plans remain unexecuted. To be sure, the world is wicked. Yet God alone knows how far more corrupt it would be without the restraining example, life, and prayers of the saints. Salt acts secretly. This is good. Salt acts secretly. We know that it combats decay, though we cannot see it. It performs its task. Its influence is very real nonetheless. Jesus said that we're the salt of the earth. As Christians, we're to prevent decay. We're to prevent corruption, not be a part of it, but to prevent corruption. I'm to be the salt of the world. And then he says this. He says, I'm to be like light. You're to be like light as a Christian. We're to be like light. Have you ever been in a cave and they turned out the lights? I have, and I won't be there again. But they turned out the lights and you can't see your hand in front of your face. But in the darkness, any level of light makes the greatest difference and can show you the way to go. The smallest light stands out and can show the way to go. God says that our lives to be a light is to be a light to show people the way to Jesus. The darker the night, the brighter the light. The darker the night, the brighter the light. Hey, what's the brightest light? Think about it. What would be the brightest light that I could be or demonstrate to show someone Jesus? Well, it might be love. Because he said this, he said, by this shall all men know you're my disciples if you have love one for another. So love might be the brightest light that I could shine, that somebody would see Jesus in me if I would do that and live that way. Do you know, let me ask you this, did you know that God knows where you work at? I hope you're still working there. Do you know that God knows where you work at? Do you know that God put you there? That God put you there. Apparently, God thought they needed light there. God thought they needed light there. If you're going to be a light, you're going to have to opt out of the darkness around you. If you're going to be a light, you're going to have to opt out of the darkness that's around you. You're going to have to say sometimes, count me out. Just count me out. Our lives should be so distinctly different that we're like a light showing what God is like. That our life is like a light showing what God is like. The world doesn't understand that, and they'll often want to know why. And I know I speak of this often, but I'm going to say it again. I remember Brother Mark when he got saved in high school. We all played basketball. The group on the basketball team were real close, and we hung out together a lot. And when Mark came back, and Mark was different, Mark was just like the rest of us before, but he wasn't anymore. And when he came back and when he was different, everybody wanted to know why. I wanted to know why. They wanted to know why. We'd take tracts out of his pocket to read them. He'd give us tracts, trying to witness to them. He showed light. He showed light. And I didn't understand what the light was at that time, but I came to understand more about it from seeing Mark's life and from seeing how he lived. He took it to school with him. That's the cool thing. He got saved in the summer on June the 8th, and he took it to school with him on the 1st of September, and he showed the light. Read one other verse, and I'm almost done. Philippians chapter 2, verse 14 and 15. Paul says, do all things without murmurings and disputings. That convicts me, because I murmur and dispute, gripe sometimes. Do all things without murmuring and disputings, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Among whom you shine as lights in the world. I want to encourage you. The encouragement is this. Be ready to be counted out. Be ready to be counted out. Be ready to count for Jesus and be counted out of the things that would work to the other direction. I want to read you something, and don't forget the book, just $5 to this ministry in a handkerchief too, okay? Don't forget the book. Let me read you what he says, the last part of this. He says, are you shining like a star in that darkness? If you were the only point of light by which your co-workers could navigate toward the refuge of God, would there be enough brightness to guide them? It can't happen if you extinguish yourself out of fear of rejection or disapproval. It can happen if we extinguish ourselves because we're afraid of being rejected or we're afraid of disapproval. And he finishes, instead of letting others set the pace for you, why not become a pace setter yourself, a leader for Christ-like thinking and influence in the workplace? God knows that our workplace today needs to have a Christian influence. You say, I can't succeed if I do that. You won't ultimately succeed if you don't do that. The world needs to see that people can can live in this world and work in this world and function in this world and honor God at the same time. And that's the challenge that we have as he titles the book, To Keep Our Ethical Edge Sharp. Hey, I love you. I miss being at church. I miss seeing everybody at Sunday school. I've been able to talk to a few of you on the phone. But I pray that the Lord will bless you. Man, if we can help you with anything. I know Wes says this all the time, and I'm not the pastor, but if I can help you in any way, please give me a call. Let's pray, and we'll finish up. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for the Word of God. I thank you for Jesus, Lord. I thank you that you saved my soul, Lord, back in 1972. And Lord, that you made me willing to be counted out as far as the world was concerned, Lord, to be counted in as far as Jesus was concerned. God, give us a holy desire and give us boldness and help us to be careful to walk with you every day, Lord, so that we have the confidence that you're talking about in the Word of God. We praise you, Lord. I pray you'd meet every need of the folks in our church. Lord, bless them in a special way. While we're apart, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.